Okay, thank you everybody for coming. This afternoon's lecture is by the Scoil director, Siobhán Armstrong, and she's going to talk about her recent research.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. In the 1530s, King Henry VIII of England formed a new administration in Ireland to reinvigorate the English agenda of the previous 350 years. So his courtiers replaced Irish-born old English lords in key positions, and the confiscation of land, you're not supposed to be seeing that yet, take it away, and the confiscation of land for English settlers began in earnest. So the subjugation of Ireland by ruling class aristocrats sent from London was steamrolled by military aggression, culminating in the 9 Years' War, with Irish capitulation at the Battle of Kinsale to Lake of Snow in 1603, followed by all-out colonisation in the succeeding centuries. But away from that sort of tawdry business of conquest during the day, the new English in Ireland sang. They played viols, they played lutes, they played keyboard instruments, and they were completely enamoured of the mesmerising sound of the early Irish harp, which was the apogee of Gaelic musical culture. The aristocratic colonists also employed Irish harpers, and they even brought them back home with them when their period of office in Ireland came to an end. So there's an interesting contradiction between, on the one hand, the Tudor narrative of Ireland as this sort of filthy, barbaric place with uncivilised people, and also the legal myths from Henry, and mainly then from Elizabeth I, his daughter, banishing harpers and poets. While the very same Tudors, the very people who are writing the writs, not only employ Irish musicians in Ireland, but again, take them back home with them. In addition, Irish music and Irish harpers became not only fashionable in aristocratic England, but James I and his queen each had an Irish harper of their own in the early 17th century. So in 1541, Henry VIII became the first English monarch to become the King of Ireland rather than the Lord of Ireland, as English monarchs had been in the period before. So there's no time in such a short lecture to get into the politics and what followed. But it's safe to say that the 16th century was a terribly sad period for the native Irish, for the Gaelic, and the old English who lived in Ireland, for those of them who sided with the Gaelic. Who are the old English? So they're the descendants of the French-speaking invaders who arrived at the end of the 12th century. But of course they go native. So they're more, almost more Irish than the Irish. So the new English arriving in, the Tudors, should really have a natural bedfellows in the old English. And they do to some extent, but in other respects they do not. The aristocratic Tudors sent to subdue Ireland brought their own music culture, as I say, lutes, viols, keyboard instruments, and household records show evidence for the types of music performance and the patronage of the musicians that took place in these Anglo households. They also retained musicians of their own. Tudor households in Ireland would have followed some or all of the usual European Renaissance practice of singing polyphonic madrigals for several voices. This is what you do after dinner. You sit around the table with your madrigal and you sing madrigals, or playing solo and instrumental chamber music on viols and recorders and lutes. Singing songs to lute or consort accompaniment. It's a consort, so it can be a group of like instruments or dissimilar ones, so four recorders or four violas, viols together, or maybe a recorder and a viol and a lute, or whatever you have around. So, and they played keyboard instruments such as the virginals. Primary sources exist for all this music, so we're in a very lucky position that we have no problem recreating or reconstructing English music of the 16th century. So it's easy to know the style of the music, for example, that the early 16th century invaders enjoyed. So have a listen.
Language is the same, right?
still a courtly language in the early 16th century. Including the harbour of Lord Delvin in County Westmeath, for example. Sidney first came to Ireland in 1556, and in 1559 we have him buying a pair of virginals. So that's not two instruments, it's one keyboard instrument of the harpsichord family called a pair of virginals, and two lutes. During further stays in Ireland, he ordered a set of viols in 1566, these elegantly shaped bowed instruments that come in different sizes from bass to treble. In 1569, a case of new instruments. We'll never know what was in it. Payment records exist from him to musicians probably associated with the Dublin City Waits of the late 1560s and to the choristers of Christchurch, Dublin in 1568 for having presented him new songs and new verse. His wife, Lady Mary, played virginals and lute, and in fact, some of his children were then connected or were patrons to some of the most famous English Renaissance composers. The Renaissance lute would have been very familiar to the colonists and loyalists in Ireland and was played in the Pale, that area within English government around Dublin. Because, of course, much of Ireland was never under English control in the northwest, the west, and the southwest. But the area around Dublin was, and in fact, there was a second Pale here in Kilkenny, which this was also a very Anglo city. So the Renaissance lute would have been very familiar to them all, and a lute appears alongside Irish harps and virginals in an inventory of the goods of a Jacques Winfield. I presume it's pronounced Jack, but it's spelled Jacques in French. Jacques Winfield in Dublin in 1589. It says two pair of virginals, a frame for the virginals. That's the thing that the harp, the harpsichords and virginals sit on with the legs. Two Irish harps, one lute. And in 1597, the Jesuit Henry Fitzsimon celebrated High Mass in the house of a nobleman in Dublin, the first such for 40 years, with full orchestra composed of harps, lutes, and all kinds of instruments except the organ. Back to the colonists. Sir William Fitzwilliam. This is Henry Sidney's brother-in-law. All these aristocratic Tudors of Ireland tend to be all related to each other, their brothers-in-law, their sons, they're these enormous family relations. In fact, Tudor aristocracy in general was all intermarried and interrelated. So Henry Sidney, this is Henry Sidney's brother-in-law. He succeeded him as Lord Deputy in 1571. And he also enjoyed domestic music, I think, and he patronized musicians as Sidney had done before him. Fitzwilliam himself retained a harper of the name of Plunkett. His household accounts from 1591 show payments for materials to make cases for harps belonging to him, along with payments for wire for harp strings and for drawing the wire into the required gauges or the thicknesses that you would use on your harp. This is really interesting in light of the fact that the harpers were considered highly dubious and highly undesirable within their own Gaelic contexts. But once they were sort of civilized in a colonial context, they were sort of colonial trophies. In the way that in the 18th century you would have your Indian footman. So in the 16th century you would have your Irish footman, and then you would have your Irish harper. So it's sort of like Indian and Chinese people in the 18th century, we were the exotic oriental flavor in British establishments in the 16th century. So the harpers are in some ways can be seen as colonial trophies. Though the esteem, for example, in which they're held, and we'll talk a little later about the Irish harper Cormac MacDermot, he was held in such incredibly high esteem by his colleagues. There seems to be a genuine admiration for Irish harping among the members of the English aristocracy. So that implies to me that they could somehow transcend that Orientalist colonial trophy role and be taken seriously as the wonderful musicians that they were. So John Perrott was sent to Ireland in 1571 by Queen Elizabeth I to establish a colonial government in Munster, in the southern half of Ireland. He was Lord Deputy for 4 years from 1584, and he retained six musicians as Fitzwilliam had before him. A fiat, or a legal writ, issued in Perrott's first year as Lord Deputy stated that no harper, rhymer, poet, carol, carvach, as it's a gander, or valiant, beggar, shall pass here the said parishes, but shall be put into the said stocks and punished according to their deserts. Highly ironic, given that these official orders were ignored by the very men who issued them. Perrott himself was a patron of William Bath, who played the Irish harp in addition to the lute. He was in Dublin. And Perrott also himself employed an Irish harper, Richard Barrett, and brought this harper back to Wales with him when he was finished his tour of duty and retired back to his castle in Pembroke. Then we have the first Earl of Essex, who came to Ireland in 1573 and attempted to subdue Ulster with ruthless military campaigns, massacres of civilians, and extensive plantation. He was always on the move, but he found the time to retain a band of musicians himself and made payments in 1575 to the singing men at Mellifont Abbey in County Louth. Also to the 10th Earl of Ormond's household musicians here in Kilkenny and in Carrickashore, and to three harpers, those of Sir John Bellew, Sir Peter Carew, and George Cruse, who was the Earl of Ormond's own harper. This region, as you have seen, we're on Ormond Road. We are in the middle of Ormond territory here, where we sit this evening. Then we have Sir William Russell, who came to Ireland in a military campaign in 1580, and he came back as Lord Deputy in 1594. And he's known to have maintained a consort of musicians. On New Year's Day in 1596 in Dublin, certain lords and gentlemen presented my lord with a mask, with an upper class, all male cast, with the presence of professional instrumentalists not recorded. Now a mask is like an aristocratic or royal variety show. You have some singing, some dancing, some instrumental music, some speech, and even the royals up to the kings and queens would take part in these masks. So they were very costly entertainments and probably brought down the government of Charles I and contributed to it later in the 17th century to him having his head cut off. But that's for another talk entirely. We get to my man, Sir Thomas Butler, Thomas Dolph Butler. So take a good look at this man. He is here at the castle in Kilkenny, and he also has a medieval castle and a beautiful Elizabethan manor house, the only one in the country, very fashionable new house that he builds in the 16th century to go with it. Now I'm thinking next year I'm going to give a longer talk on the Butlers and their harpers, so I'll try not to get too much better this year and save something. He's the wealthiest and the most powerful noble in Ireland in the second half of the 16th century. He's the exception in this list because he's not newly arrived English. He's Irish born, of old English stock. He was, however, completely and utterly loyal to the English crown because he was educated at court with Elizabeth and with her brother Edward. And he enjoyed a lifelong personal relationship with the Queen. And that's because he was her cousin. So Elizabeth I's mother is Anne Boleyn, and her mother was Margaret Butler from Carrickashore. So Elizabeth I's granny was from Carrickashore, so this makes her a cousin of Sir Thomas Butler. He He fought his own factional fights, and he also fought very hard on her behalf against both old English and Gaelic lords in Ireland. The English writer Thomas Churchyard, who visited him, in Carrick on Shore in Kilkenny for Christmas in 1575, mentioned all these typically aristocratic entertainments, music, masks, and maypoles. Ormond travelled regularly to London, sometimes he would spend years in the court in London, so it was he who was probably responsible for bringing Irish music to the English court. Surviving vocal repertory from Ireland pre-1600 is rather sparse, and of course, I think we all understand why. There's a sort of a whole cultural genocide that started in the 16th century that went all the way through, you know, through the 18th century. So we have a huge dearth of manuscripts, and of course, the whole of society was basically destroyed, and Irish music is a medieval oral tradition. So much of it was never written down anyway. So once you disturb the society and you don't have written records, lots of things are going to get lost along the way. But there is one song, Cailín Ó Chois Siúda Mé, I am a girl from the banks of the shore. And the shore was the river that Sir Thomas Butler's castle was on in Carrick on Shore, which is about 40 minutes from here. So Cailín Ó Chois Siúda Mé was the very first Irish song to be referenced outside the Gaelic world. This is the earliest extant version of the piece. And you can see here, C-A-L-L-I-N-O, Cailín-O. It had many phonetic titles in English, but this is the earliest version in the Ballad Lute Book. This part of the Ballad Lute Book probably comes from 1595 to just after the century, maybe 1605. So the original words in Irish are lost, but in 1582 it was named as the tune of a newly composed song registered in London. So I'd like you to hear the song, and then I'd like you to hear a set of variations that the English Renaissance composer par excellence, William Byrd, very famous composer, he composed a set of variations on this tune. And further, when you're listening to the second extract, Sir Francis Bacon, who was another of the inside aristocratic tutors, who loved the early Irish harp, one of his two comments about it was that the Irish harp and bass viol doth agree well, that they do very well together. So this set of variations by William Byrd is composed with a keyboard, but it's here split into two, some of the variations played by a bass viol and some by an Irish harp, so you get to hear the two instruments together. But first, the song in English.
She did excel, calling all the school.
slightly under time pressure, I won't let you hear the end. Just to say, for anybody who isn't familiar, this is Renaissance lute tablature. It just shows you where to put your fingers on the strings so that you can play it. Let's have a little taste of the violin arm. Sorry, you'll have to. Here's where I do some marketing. You'll have to buy the CD. The CD is outside with all of this stuff on, so it's the perfect opportunity to say, I'm sorry, I can't get used to that. All right, so what were the Tudors listening to apart from Irish harpers? So, songs accompanied by the lute, consort songs accompanied by several instruments, Renaissance dances, Almains, Pavans, Galliards, typify the music that would have been familiar to the Tudors in the Pale in the second half of the century. But these were also familiar to the loyalist earls of Fitzgerald and Kildare, and the orphans in Carrick and Shore and here at Kilkenny, and to the more cultured colonists in the rural plantations. So let me see if I can get you to play, if I can get you to hear this. Ah, none of these seem to be working now. Is anybody a dab hand with PowerPoint? No, it's not the volume. I just can't, well, I can't click on it. Let me see if I can get out of the. See if it works here.
No.
Oh, that's a shame. Okay, let me get out of this and see if I can give you the sound files from here. Okay, so here's the one I wanted you to hear. So this is Irish music brought into a Renaissance English context and rearranged. So what are they listening to themselves? Well, they're listening to consort songs. For example, this kind of thing. So this is, you could sing all the lines, you could play all the lines, or you could have somebody sing one of the lines and play the rest. So this is with recorders, viols, lute, and a soprano.
Thank you.
taste, how they will think. Primary sources, as we see them, exist for... That, by the way, is the... That's a piece of... This is not my PowerPoint day. This is the treble of the piece you're listening to. So primary sources, as we can see, exist for Tudor music, but not for secular Irish music at the same time. I say secular because, of course, we're singing clay chant and all the church music, and manuscripts of that do survive. And there's a very a particularly wonderful one from St. Francis Cathedral here in Kilkenny. It's a Trinity College Dublin manuscript, cited, huge manuscript with an extraordinary quantity of clay chant. But secular Irish music, much, much trickier to get our hands on. So it's ironic that some Irish repertory of the 1500s can now only be recovered from English sources. So like the tune Cali na Castiúrile, which goes into a lute source, you have My Lady Neville's book and the Ballad Lute book and the Marsh Lute book, and Irish tunes get preserved, very ironically, from these English sources. So songs and harp compositions, which are likely to predate 1600, do survive in Irish sources, but the first of these written sources didn't exist until 250 years later, at the end of the 18th century. So in a courtly context, the harp accompanied the singing of the very sophisticated syllabic bardic poetry, and possibly also the performance of praise poems, elegies, laments, histories, genealogies. Harpers also played preludes, laments, and solo pieces. Irish harpers worked for successive English colonial patrons, as we've seen, and also in aristocratic English households. So there they would have been involved in the performance of European style music, playing airs and dances, brawls, almains, galliards, pavans, music for the mask, and they would probably also have performed one or more voices in consorts of mixed instruments. So they would have provided accompaniments, improvised over a bass line in instrumental and vocal pieces, and would perhaps also play grand bass patterns, these repeating patterns that you can improvise over, and all the melodic divisions that were improvised over them. So what do we know about these Irish harpers? There's George Cruse, the Earl of Ormond's blind harper here in Kilkenny and in Carrickshire, who travelled to London in the Earl's retinue. So he was an extremely accomplished musician. He was a star harper. And it's likely to have been he who introduced the song Cali na Castiúrile to the London court while he was living there in the 1570s. As I say, I think I'd like to talk more about him next year because he's really quite an interesting character here in Kilkenny. The Earl of Ormond's grandfather, the 8th Earl, Pierce Rua Butler, he had also employed a harper unnamed who was in residence in a Butler castle around between 1499 and 1500, and it might be this man, William O'Coolahan. Then we have the Scot, we have Richard Barrett, who is the harper to Perrot, and we talked about him before. Then we have the Scot dynasty, so we have John and Harry Scott from Kent West Meath. They're called Albanach in Irish, so you have Eamon Albanach, seems to be of the same dynasty. There are four in this dynasty. There's Ned Scott, who's called Eamon Albanach. He's harper to Lord Chichester. And there's a Darby Scott, who had an appointment at the Danish royal court early in the next century. And this is probably a painting of Darby Scott playing with a bass viol and a lute and a flute. So this is the kind of broken consort, as we call it. Not the same instruments, different instruments, therefore a broken consort that I want you to sort of get a feel for the sound for. This is the kind of thing that survived 250 years afterwards. This is John Scott's lamentation for the Baron of Lochmoe, Purcell. And of course, that's only about 40 minutes away here, just the far side of Thurles, in County Tipperary, the next county. We have this enormous Purcell, ruined Purcell castle in Lochmoe, which is now called Lochmore. So this esoteric lament in the manuscript was composed in the years just before or after 1600 by John Scott for Thomas Purcell, who was the Baron of Lochmoe. So I'll just give you a tiny little taste of that, if I can find it. Thank you. perhaps a Gaelic nobleman who's supposed to have been from one of the most important clans in the north, whose lands lay around Coleraine in County Derry. And he's said to have left Ireland but stayed in the Gaelic world, moving to Scotland, possibly in the first decade of the 17th century. His music survives in Scottish lute manuscripts, again, lute tablature. Give you a tiny taste of him. He's one of the earliest Irish harpists documented in England. He became the harper to Sir Robert Cecil, the first Earl of Salisbury, who was possibly, arguably, the most important man in England after the Queen, sometime in the late 1590s. Cecil's father, Lord Burghley, had been Queen Elizabeth's closest advisor for decades, and Robert Cecil himself was Lord High Treasurer of England. MacDermot is very different to many other Irish harpers of the 16th century and the centuries before and after, in that he was not blind. And he joined a very illustrious group of musicians at the Earl's splendid estate in Hatfield House. The ensemble included the lute composer Anthony Holborn, Nicholas Lanier, who would later rise to the position of King Charles I's Master of the Music, and occasionally the composer John Comprario. When Salisbury's first cousin, this is Francis Bacon again, the renowned polymath Francis Bacon, he wrote his much quoted, "No instrument had the sound so melting and prolonged as the Irish harp." He's probably talking about Cormac MacDermot, because you probably heard it at his house. So there are many, I think we need to finish up. So there are other harpists, Daniel Duffield Cahill, who is contemporary of, partially contemporary of MacDermot's, and he's at court at the same time. And he worked in the household of two English queens, Anne of Denmark, who's married to James I, she's from Copenhagen, until her death in 1619, and from 1629, he was employed by Henrietta Maria, the wife of Charles I. He outlived MacDermot by 4 decades. I think MacDermot might have died of plague. So O'Cahill outlives him by a long way. So we'll talk about him more in the 17th century talk. So to finish off, I just want you to hear some of the music of Cormac MacDermot. He's the epitome of the colonial hybrid. He's an Irish harper living in England. He's composing music in an English Renaissance style, and he's playing with the finest musicians in England at a stately home, and then at the royal court. 8 of his compositions survive, all of them court dances in 3 parts and 5 parts. They're really exceptional, as the only surviving compositions by an Irish composer composing in the European Renaissance idiom. So I'll just leave you with the sound, but I wanted to point out also that the singer that you heard singing the Henry VIII pieces and the Cunning of the Shurame is a man from the banks of the shore, and since he's with them tonight, I think we have to compliment him. Thanks for that. I'll leave you with Almain Mr. Cormac. So, 3 viols, a Renaissance lute, and an Irish harp.
Thank you. See, doesn't Shakespeare, in one of his plays, mention...
He mentions Calais Costume. It's pistol, it's a Henry V, and there's all this thing about speaking French, and he starts speaking all this gobbledygook, his Calais Costume. Yeah, so he uses it, Shakespeare uses it in his play.
And we have a Gaelic song in Scotland called Calais Costume.
Costume, and you have a version of that, so maybe you'll have to sing that first later on. Because I know there's a version in Gregor Lauer's village. He has a version of that.
Yeah.
Is that the version that you know?
No, I don't.
Different one.
I'd
be so curious because I haven't heard
the
Calais Costume. I'd be really, really curious to hear that as well. But I think the tune is very different, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's not the same tune.